So we are jumping right back into Doors, a series about doors you need to go into, doors that you shouldn't go into, doors that should be closed in your life, doors that should be wide open in your life. And before we get into that, I want to thank you for walking through these doors today. Thank you for being here. I want to thank the people up in our Hartsel and Madison campus. We are one church in worshiping a lot of different places. And I want to say to everybody, I'm going to be, Encounter is at Hartsel tonight at 6 o'clock. If you have never been to our Hartsel campus, that'd be a great chance for you to come. I'm going to be speaking tonight. Pastor Tom normally speaks, but he's going to let me preach this time. So I'm excited about that. And you talk about going through a new door. Encounter is a supernatural experience. So that's tonight. But listen, I'm super glad you guys came on board. There's a lot of people that went through a electronic door, you know, online to join us today, a virtual door. And I'm glad you're here today too. So thank you. And I hope you'll come and be with us in person as soon as you possibly can. I'm talking about today, I'm going to tell you a story about the upper room. Actually, there were actually two upper rooms that Jesus's small group went through. You know, next week we launch small groups, and there's a biblical reason for it. There is a real reason that you need to be connected with people who are moving in the same direction that you're moving in. It's like moving with birds migrating south for the winter. Look at this picture. You always see them like this in V formation. That's always how the birds look, right? Because we know that in that formation, they're all helping each other, you know? They're helping each other stay focused, like you're not going to ever see like a V with all these geese and then this weird goose over here doing his thing. That's never the way. Like they're always focused. It helps you get where you're going when you're with the right people. It kind of gives you the direction that you're supposed to be going in. We also know that the goose in the front is the only one that's getting a full headwind. All the rest of them, the journey is easier. And they actually, you know, people have watched the migratory patterns of geese, and they rotate the head bird. So you know, in your own group, you know, you're never the leader all the time. But there's going to be a time when you're lifting others up, and there's going to be a time when other people are lifting you up. That really is the way small groups work. You know, you find a group of people who are going where you're going, trying to become the kind of person that you're trying to become, and then you just don't do it by yourself. Now, this small group that Jesus led, we know them as the 12 disciples, right? That's become a famous statement, the 12 disciples. And you know what? They were a pretty different kind of bunch, you know? A lot of adjectives I could use to describe them, but they definitely didn't have it all together. But they reached a destination, and they end up changing the world. You don't have to have it all together. But there's two different times Jesus called them to go behind the door of the upper room. Now, you probably, if you know the Bible, probably immediately think about Acts chapter 2, the story of the upper room. But actually, that was the second time they went behind the door of the upper room. And I want to talk you through both of those doors. I want you to see what happened in their life. So if you've got your Bible, I want you to go with me to Mark chapter 14. Actually, as you're getting there, I want to tell you that the notes that I normally give you today, you've just got a bunch of blank lines. You're going to have to write it all down. We had a really amazing week of missions work. This week has been so cool. So we got a group going to Bahamas next week. They're going to be rebuilding houses destroyed by Hurricane Dorian. Right now, this morning already, our mission team has already had a great service at Daystar in Uganda. We've actually got a picture of Pastor Kip, who was preaching this morning. There he is. That is, look at that look on his face. He's like, you better listen to me this morning. I want to tell you, that's Kip's people right there. You may not know this, but Kip is, he may be American on the outside, but he is African on the inside. Jason went over there with him on a trip one time. He said, we have found Kip's people. They don't care what time you get there. They don't care what time you leave. He can preach as long as he wants to preach. The louder he gets, the more they like it. Those are his people, all right? And they're having a great mission over there, doing some great work, sharing the gospel with people in that nation. And this week, I actually spent 3 days on the Mexican side of the border. And we're going to try to put together some missions work for a lot of immigrants that are really struggling and in abject poverty. They're going through so much terrible stuff. I won't go into that today, only to tell you that what you see in the news is fake. It is not what's actually happening over there. And churches are responding and blessing people in need, because that's what the church does. The church always rises above politics and public opinion and just loves on people who are in need. Is that what we are? That's who we do. That's what we do, and that's who we are. So anyways, I kind of got back late, and so I didn't get my notes turned in time for them to print them all out for you. So you're going to have to write all this stuff down today, but I'll walk you through it. We're going to start in Mark chapter 14. Mark 14 and verse 13. It says Jesus. Jesus sent two of his disciples, telling them, go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him, and say to the owner of the house he enters, the teacher asks, where is my guest room? Now, it's pretty random. Like, he's going to meet this guy. This guy's going to be doing this very thing. It's really cool how Jesus prophesies, lays it all out. And he says, you're going to ask him, where may I eat the Passover with my disciples? And he will show you a large, everybody say, upper room. An upper room furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there. Now, the really cool thing about this story today is you're going to find Jesus' small group goes to two upper rooms. And both of them in the original language, they're both in Greek, the same language, but the words for the rooms are different. Now, they're translated into English as our same two words, upper room. But when the words were spoken, when Jesus spoke these words, he said a different word for upper room here than we're going to read about in the book of Acts. It's really cool. So this word for upper room here in the original language is the Greek word anogion, anogion. And if you like to write that stuff down, it's A-N-O-G-E-O-N. And it just means an above ground room on the second floor. Everybody say, second floor. He says, here's what I want you to do. You're going to go find this man. He's going to take you to an upper room on the second floor, and you wait for me there. And this is where things are going to change. Now, this is literally the place where Jesus shared the Last Supper with them. This is the place where he took them literally to a second level. They had been followers of Jesus. They had watched what Jesus had done. They had no really understanding of the big picture of what was going on. This is that place where Jesus says, unless you're ready to eat my flesh and drink my blood, you can have no part in me. He draws a real line of distinction. We know now, of course, that was communion. That's when you take the bread, that's a symbol of Jesus' flesh that was beaten at Calvary. And when you take the juice, it's a symbol of his blood that was poured out for us. But Jesus was drawing a line in the sand, and he used that powerful language for a reason. He wanted them to know, this is serious, dude. This is not a snack, okay? This is not us eating supper. This is drawing the line in the sand and saying, you're going to be persecuted. People are going to hate you. This is not nominal faith. This is second level faith. This is taking your faith to the next level. Later on, when Jesus says this same thing to the masses, most of them leave him. In the Middle Ages, you have thousands, tens of thousands of Christians who are martyred for their faith because they're believed to be cannibals because Jesus made this statement. And you know what? Jesus knew that when he said it. What he was doing was drawing a line of distinction between street level Christianity and second level Christianity. And you know what? That line is still drawn today, and Jesus is still trying to tell us to go behind this door, to go to the upper room. You know, there's a street-level Christianity. What I call first level is just, yeah, I'm a Christian. What are you? I'm a Christian. So, you know, you get checked into the hospital, and they give you a survey, and you check which religion are you, you know? You could have checked, you know, Islam, or you could have checked Buddhism or an atheist, and you check Christianity. That's street-level Christianity. If I could be honest, in a nation full of a lot of Christians, that's where most of the Christians live, street-level Christianity. You know, I'll come to church occasionally, you know, every Easter, every Christmas. I might, you know, be a generous person on occasion when things really touch my heart, but I'm going to live how I want to live. I'm going to do what I want to do and just kind of believe in Jesus. And Jesus was saying to these disciples, that's not okay. I want you to go to the next level. I want you to go behind this upper room. This is a place of genuine worship. It's a place of communion where they embrace Jesus for everything that he was. And I want to give you a few facts about going to the second level that are laid out in this story right here. So if you're taking notes, you just write like second level facts. Just put a line under that. I'm going to tell you three things that you can put under there. Here's the first one. Number one, only Jesus can take you to the second level. he says, the verse actually says Jesus sent the disciples there. You're not going to get there because you're the best looking person in this room, okay? Man, I want to be like that person. He must be a second. It doesn't matter how you look. It doesn't matter what people think about you. That won't bring you there. It really doesn't matter if you give a lot of money or if you sing on the worship team. It's an embrace of Jesus that takes you to that place. When you fall in love with him, when you wrap your life, we sang a song that says, I will build my life upon your love. When that goes from being a song, see, street level Christians sing that song, second level Christians live that song. Amen. I'm going to build my life. I genuinely am going to ask you, how many kids should I have? What college should I go to? Is this the person I should date? You know, who? Not in that order, by the way. I think I laid that out backwards, but you were with me, okay? sorry about that. I'm asking the big questions and the small. Should I buy this car? What house should I live in? All those questions are built on Jesus. That's the level of communion. That's the level of saying, you know, I'm not going to just think about you occasionally. I'm going to ingest you into my life. And Jesus is the one that makes that happen in your life. Here's the second thing you'll find. While no man can take you there, only Jesus can. Write this down. Jesus will send someone to show you the way. Now, that's what he did here. He says, you're going to go to this place, and you're going to find a man carrying a pitcher of water, and you're going to follow him. And when you follow him, he's going to lead you where? To the upper room. Now, that's pretty random. You're going to meet this guy, and when you meet this guy, you're going to follow him, and you're going to end up in this place. See, God will send somebody in your life to show you the way. He'll send somebody, and this is an unusual example. You know, how did he know where the man was going to be? And that the man would be carrying a pitcher of water, and that when he was carrying the pitcher of water, he would be going to this upper room, and that they would actually, you know, wherever they came from, that the timing would be perfect, that they would meet this guy. How did he know all that? Well, the answer is he's Jesus, and he knows stuff. Knows stuff about your life, too, and he coordinates stuff, and he puts people in your path the way that he wants it to happen, and he puts people in your path that will pique your curiosity and get your attention. Let me tell you why this got their attention. Other than, of course, Jesus telling them to look for it. It's unusual in these days for a man to carry a pitcher of water. They had very clearly defined roles. Men did this kind of work. Women did this kind of work. And women were the water carriers. Men didn't do that part of the work. It was unusual to see it. And Jesus said, this is the guy you're going to follow. You know what that tells me is God will send something to pique your interest. And he'll take you. And it might be strange. It might not be what you want to follow. It might not be the step that you want to take. It could be a message. It could be a prophetic word. Somebody just encourages you and says some things. They inspire you with their life, and you follow them. Like Paul said to his believers in his congregation, he said, you just follow me while I follow Jesus. There's flesh on this walk, faith walk, okay? It's not all of us just staring up to heaven. God will layer your life with people of influence, spiritual influence and authority to lead you to where you need to go. Sometimes it'll be just for a moment, a song that you heard in worship and that worship leader inspired you. Sometimes it'll be a relationship that goes for a long time. Sometimes it'll be the last person you want to follow. Like one night I was watching Christian television, and I was only watching this guy because I couldn't stand him. Am I the only person that does that? My wife thinks I have a disorder, you know, that I watch the news to fuss at the screen. She's like, they can't hear you, honey. Turn the channel. And I do that with Christian TV as well. And I'm just mad at this guy. And then he says something profound. And I'm like, dadgummit. I'm going to have to listen to that and do that now. And you know what? God will send strange, unexpected, maybe a challenge. You know what? For some of you, it's the move journey. That big risk that you're taking, it's kind of bumping you off center. God will do things like that are unusual and are uncommon in your life to cause you to go to a second level. Here's what you have to decide. Do I want to be comfortable? Do I want to meet God? That's your choice. Do I want it to be the same old, things that I can understand, that I can explain to my friends, or do I want to do something I've never done before and go to a whole different level with God? That's what the second level looks like. God's the only one that can take you there, but he'll send somebody to help lead you there. And here's the last thing about that. The place, according to this story, is already, number three, it's already prepared for you. It's already laid out. He said, you're going to find a man carrying a pitcher of water. You're going to follow him. You're going to go to an upper room, and you'll find out it's already prepared. Every time that God leads you to places, every time that God says, I want you to go somewhere behind a new door, you're going to find out he's already got something there waiting on you. He has a better plan for your life on the other side of that door. It might be a scary journey for you. It might be a questionable decision in some ways, but you can rest assured God has placed these breakthroughs in your life. He's placed these opportunities in your life, and there's already an answer for you on the other side. Man, you might have been praying about something for a long time, and God, you're asking for a miracle from God, and God speaks to you and says, hey, you know what I want you to do? Forget about that miracle and just chase me for a while. Forget about what you're asking, that worry that you've got. put it on the back burner and just chase after me. Just be generous with your affection and love to me. Just share your faith with somebody. Just follow this leader. And you know, all these different ways he might be calling you to set your will aside, because here's what you might find, that on the other side of the door is the answer. That it's already prepared for you. There's already something there for you. And see, that's a place where some separation begins to happen. You go to a whole new level, you'll see some separation. You had 12 disciples go to that upper room, but one of them left early. What was his name? Remember Judas? Remember Judas? Judas shot out the side door. You know, there was a supernatural worship moment going in there, because the second level, man, it's not street level Christianity. They're embracing him. They're taking communion with him. They're receiving the body and blood of Christ, and it's a supernatural experience. And man, Judas over at the corner, he gets all nervous, you know. Jesus looks at him and says, hey man, do what you're going to do. And he shoots off out the side door, and he goes and does what he's going to do. And you know what? That's one of the most beautiful. A place of separation is one of the best places you can be in. Man, because there are people in your circle right now that are not going to the next level, and if you're not careful, they'll keep you out of the next level. I know it like I know my way home, y'all. It's a fact. There are people who are keeping you with the wrong associates. You're spending your most time with the wrong person. Let me just stop for a minute, put my daddy hat on, and say to teenagers in this room, you're dating the wrong person, some of you. And they're going to hold you back from where you want to go. You're trying to make a decision. And the best thing, let me tell you what's best about the upper room, is the people who don't need to be there with you won't go. Hallelujah. That's awesome. Because eventually, there's going to be a decision made. Either you're going to go where God wants you to go and they exit stage right, or you're going to go where they want to go and you miss the will of God for your life. Man, better to find it out right now. Girls, you're dating some guy. You know, he's got everything right. He's got the eyes and the eyelashes and the hair. And he's so cool, except the fact that he doesn't love Jesus. And I'm going to help him because I'm going to missionary date him into the kingdom of God. That doesn't work, okay? You don't date him into the kingdom. It don't work that way. And what you're going to find out is, the quicker you go to the next level, the quicker the wrong guy leaves the room. Oh, I'm preaching better than y'all, amen, in this morning. I'm going to help you, okay? And let me tell you something, guys. There's some girls, too, that need to go out the left door, too. And, you know, you're dating the wrong person. The quicker you go to the next level, the quicker you get them out of your life. Because the worst thing that can happen is you keep meandering around here at street level, nominal, not very passionate Christianity, and you hang out with the wrong people, and then you get married to the wrong person, you have children with the wrong person, and you finally get to a place where you need a miracle. You need what's on the other side of that door. You really need God in your life, and you get ready to go, and he's like a boulder tied around your neck holding you back. Let me tell you what you need to do. Stop focusing on the guy or the girl and put your eyes on Jesus. Get as close to Jesus as you can. It's going to do two things. That's going to exit stage right. The joker didn't need to be in your life to start with. The other thing is, let me tell you, some of you are praying for that guy. Man, I hear girls all the time. I'm just praying for God to send the right one. Let me tell you something. The fastest way for you to find the right one is for you to become the right one. Because the right guy is praying for the right girl. I promise you, if he's the right guy, he's going to the upper room. He's seeking God. He's asking God for, and you know what? So many girls, you know, you want to find your Prince Charming, but you don't want to be Cinderella. You got to be the right person. You guys are the same way. You want to see this woman of God, this woman of faith in your life. Well, then step up and be a man of God, because they're praying for the right person. Quit looking for them and look for him. He'll make you the right person, and then he'll give you the desires of your heart. He'll fill you with everything you need in your life. Come on, somebody help me out now. I'm preaching better than you, amen, in today. You go in here and stuff that didn't need to be in your circle or in your life goes out. And hallelujah for that. Because when you hold on to the thing that God never wanted you to have, not only is it going to keep you from God, but it's going to keep the right person out of your life. There's no room for him or her to get there because you've got the wrong person in that room. So they go to the next level. And Judas exits stage right. And they have genuine communion with God. Genuine worship. They start to really genuinely feel what it's like to just be in love with him. Before that, they're asking him, when will we overthrow Rome? What are we going to do about? They start to put that aside. And they just genuinely begin to embrace him. And then what happens next? What happens next after this upper room experience? The crucifixion. They're thinking to themselves, you got to be kidding me, God. You know, we finally came to really know him. We finally came to genuinely know he's the Son of God, to embrace him as our own. Now they take him away. They hang him on a cross. He dies. And what do? They scatter for a moment. But like all good groups do, they come back together and they pray for each other. They encourage each other. They support one another. And Jesus meets them. Jesus is resurrected and he meets them. And in Acts 1 and 8, he says, listen, I want you to go to this other place and I want you to tarry or wait there. Because when you get to this other upper room, the Holy Spirit's going to come. And everything's going to change, and my power is going to be in your life. And so that's the next place they go. I want to read that place to you, Acts chapter 1, verse 13. It says, when they had entered, they went up to the what? Say it out loud. Upper room, and where they were staying. And there's 11. All 11 of them are there. Peter, James, John, Andrew, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, and Matthew. James, the son of Alphaeus, and Simon, the zealot. And then Judas. Not Judas Iscariot, but Judas, the son of James, was the 11th one. He's often called Jude, not Judas. The 11 are there in this upper room. Now, this is the same language, the same Greek language. And even though the word upper room is translated upper room for us in English, they use a different word here. And the word there is huperoion, if you're writing that down, H-U-P-E-R-O-I-O-N. And watch this. The first place we talked about, enogion, the Greek word for the second level, is translated upper room for us. But here this word, huperoion, literally means the third story. Could it be that God is telling us that you could start at the street level and then you could move up to genuinely loving God, but then there would even be another level for you? That you'd go to the third level, that you'd go somewhere else that you've never been before, that if the second level is worship and it's communion and it's really falling in love with him, that after the resurrection there was more there. The Bible says the same power that raised Jesus from the dead is available to you. So if that's true, man, all of a sudden we go back to the upper room again. We go to a higher place and we get something we never got before. See, the third level is about life change. Everybody shout life change. You might fall in love with Jesus and get your high, you know, and genuinely believe in who he is. But eventually Jesus is going to say, that's good. Now get up and do something about it. Now get up and change. Now get up and change the world around you. That third level is where they begin to really see who God was for them. And it changes everything. At the third level, man, the church nearly split. When they came out of the upper room, man, this guy Peter, by the way, Peter, who at first, he's drawing his sword before the upper room. And he's going to fight for Jesus to not go to the cross. Well, that was the plan of God all along. He had gone to the first upper room, you following me, where communion went down. And Jesus told them, hey, what's about to happen to me is supposed to happen. It's going to be bloody. It's going to be about my flesh. Peter missed it. Peter loved Jesus, but he still missed it. And so when the temple guards came to take Jesus, he drew his sword. He cut off the ear of the guard named Malchus, right? He's literally fighting a will of God. Did you know you can be passionate and really love Jesus and still be fighting the will and the plan of God? That's why you need to go higher. That's why you got to go deeper. That's why you can't be a surface level Christian. So now Peter, he's gone to the third level. He's been in the upper room. He's filled with the Holy Spirit. The next thing, it's like all of a sudden he gets a vision of what this thing's all about. This is the first time the disciples really understand. Jesus didn't come to earth to overthrow an earthly kingdom, but to overthrow a spiritual kingdom. He didn't come to establish an earthly kingdom, but to establish a spiritual, eternal kingdom. He didn't come to overthrow Rome. He came to raise up God's children to be sons and daughters of God. Finally, Peter gets this. He comes out of the upper room the second time around when he's been to the third level in Acts chapter 2, and he preaches the gospel and 3,000 people are saved. What I'm telling you is God wants to give you a vision for your life. He wants you to know why he's doing what he's doing in your life. He wants to show you what that looks like, and that's going to require you to go to a different place. And it's going to require sacrifice. And it's going to require some dedication. You know, after that upper room, they sold all of their, not just those in the upper room, but all the believers sold all their possessions. They pooled them together as the church, gave it out as was needed. They went everywhere planting churches. They gave up their lives because the upper room is a launching pad. Here's what I hear God saying to me about us, about you and me. He wants us to go into the upper room. Because he's trying to take us from a moment to a movement, church. He's trying to do something in our church and in our lives that is a spiritual journey. It's bigger than what you've done so far in your life. It's deeper than giving to a cause. You know, it's moving you from nominal ground for Christians up to a whole nother level. God wants to take you to a second level, to a third level. Here's the beautiful thing about God. No matter how long you followed him, no matter how many times you've taken a risk or a step and you've seen what's on the other side of that door of faith, no matter how many times that's happened, there's another place for you to go. There's deeper walk with God for you to have. There's more of his blessing to be realized in your life. In fact, let me tell you some facts about going to new levels. Because God wants you to go to new levels. What happens in new levels? If you're taking notes, you might just put new levels and put an underline there. And I'm going to tell you three things under there. We'll start with this story from Daniel. You remember Daniel was the guy who was a prophet, and he heard from God. And God gave him a vision and used him mightily. This is where that began to happen in Daniel 10 and 1. It says, in the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia, a revelation was given to Daniel, who's called Belteshazzar. Its message was true, and it concerned a great war. The understanding of the message came to him in a vision. I want you to write this down. New levels equals new vision. There's nothing that'll energize you more than new vision. This time last year, I was asking God to give me a vision. Give me a fresh new word. And that's when he told me to take stupid pills. I was like, well, that's not exactly what I was looking for. But it led me to see a vision of our church, this move journey, taking us to a whole new level. And it's inspired me, and I hope it's inspired you. New vision for your life brings new energy. Do you know that where you are right now, God may be perfectly fine with where you are. You might be where you're supposed to be right now, but he has a vision of where you're supposed to go. And it's better than where you are. It's for a greater purpose, and it's for the next step for you. And when you go behind, when you go to a new level in Christ, he shows you a new vision of God's plan. He shows you what you haven't been able to see just yet. And when the book of Acts, the New Testament believers, went to that third level, they were filled with the Holy Spirit. They finally saw the purpose of God. They went in this door, and behind this door, God changed them. Then they went out of this door, and they changed the world around them. Do you know God wants to change your family? He wants to change your marriage. He wants to change your finances and your job. And I understand it, man. There are so many things that you can do to fix things. You can read this book, or you can work harder, or you can bid this job, and you can try to go make new business. There's so many things that you can do. It is so hard to put you down, the tools in your hands, put those things down and just say, you know what? I'm going to go back here with God. I'm going to stop all that. I'm going to see what God does, because on the other side of a presence of God moment, he changes you, and then you come back out and you change the world around you. What I'm trying to tell you is God could do more through you than you could ever do with your whole life. What God's calling some of you to do is to put your tools down, lift your hands up, and just say, I surrender all, God. What do you want to do in my life? I'm going to trust you for that. New levels gives you a new vision about what God wants to do in your life. Now, not everything that you happen to have when you go to a new level is fun, and I'm going to show you that right here. Daniel 10 and 2, the very next verse, he says, at that time, I, Daniel, mourned for 3 weeks. How many days is 3 weeks? Shout it out. 21 days he mourned. And he said, I ate no choice food, no meat, no wine touched my lips. No meat. Can you imagine no meat for 21 days? God made meat, y'all. God made it. He created meat. No choice foods. No yeast rolls for 21 days. No cake or pie. Whipped cream. You know what I'm saying? Just old dry strawberries with nothing on them. You might know what I'm talking about for 21 days. Whose idea was this fast anyways? This is crazy, right? This is Daniel's journey. He's like, God's taking me to a new level. And write this down. Number two, new level equals new challenges. God challenges you. See, we've messed up Christianity in the Western world, and everything God does is like a genie. We think that on the other side of this door is a genie. And when you open the door, you rub the lamp and he gives you everything you want. That is not what the Christian, that's just not what the Bible represents. It's not what the Christian walk looks like. Sometimes it's just a new challenge. It's an opportunity for you to go all in and believe for something supernatural in your life. I want to tell you, there's still time for you to do that. There's still time in this 21 days. We're in the third and final week. There's time for you to take this last week and fast something. Put something aside for the sake of God. Did you know fasting is where strongholds are broken? Somebody grabbed me in the lobby last weekend and just told me their story. It reminded me, the guy was telling me about how he'd been, an addict for much of his life. And when he and his dad and a group of men came together, they fasted and prayed for 21 days. God broke the stronghold. That's so true. Strongholds break. Maybe there's been things in your life you've had to go around and you've prayed for God to help you go around them. Sometimes when you go into this door and you take that new responsibility and new challenge to fast and pray, you stop going around the obstacle and you break through the obstacle. Strongholds are broken in your life. There's still time for you guys in this last week to get up early, come to prayer at 6 o'clock in the morning, or join us online. There's time for you to set something aside and see that God wants to do something supernatural in your life. In fact, make sure you're here Saturday, 9 o'clock. We're gonna wrap up with what I'm calling Supernatural Saturday. Supernatural. Everybody say Supernatural Saturday. I want you to come with something that you need. And if you can't be here in person, be online and type in what you're believing God for. We're going to pray for all those supernatural things to happen in your life, because fasting and prayer breaks strongholds. God wants you to go there. He wants to break something in your life. Last one I want to show you comes out of Daniel chapter 10. Come on up and play. He keeps on reading. God's giving him a vision. God's led him to fast and pray. And then the breakthrough happens. Verse 10 says, a hand touched me and set me trembling on my hands and knees. Daniel's all by himself. He's on his hands and knees. He's praying. He's been fasting. And something touches him. Have you ever been somewhere when you thought you were by yourself and somebody touched you? Don't sneak up on my wife. She will decapitate you. Arm goes flying. This guy probably freaked out. And then he heard a voice and it said, Daniel, you are highly esteemed. Consider carefully the words I'm about to speak to you and stand up, for I've now been sent to you. This is an angel, by the way, a warring angel. I'm sure it scared him, because he says, when he said this to me, I stood up trembling. And then he continued, don't be afraid, Daniel. Since the first day that you set your mind to gain understanding and humble yourself before God, from the very beginning of this 21 days of prayer and fasting, Daniel, your words were heard, and I've come in response to them. Watch this. Now, this is something I want you to note. But the prince of the Persian kingdom resisted me 21 days. What human prince could resist an angel from heaven? See, it wasn't a human prince. This is a supernatural angel, and he's talking about supernatural things. This is a demonic spirit he's talking about. Daniel, you've been praying, and God dispatched me from heaven immediately, but there's a supernatural warfare that's been going on between heaven and earth. That's what he's telling us about. He says, the prince, verse 13, the prince of the Persian kingdom resisted me 21 days. Then Michael, one of the chief princes, another, now we know who Michael is, right? Because we've read about Michael. He's the archangel. Michael is the one who's going to blast the trumpet when the saints of God are resurrected. Michael's the one, the Bible tells us, cast Lucifer out of heaven under God's authority, right? This is Michael. Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me because I was detained there with the king of Persia, this supernatural demonic force. And so he said, do you know why I have come to you? Soon I'll return and fight against the prince of Persia. And when I go, the prince of Greece will come, another demonic influence. But first, I'll tell you what's written in the book of truth. No one supports me against them except Michael, your prince. This is one of the few times the Bible pulls the curtain back and lets you see what happens in the supernatural. There's angels and demons. And when you pray, angels are dispatched. But there's a supernatural spiritual world that fights what goes on between heaven and earth. So write this third and last thing down. New levels equals new devils. You want to go to a new level? Man, there's going to be a new devil, and it might be your cousin. It might be your aunt, you know. It might be somebody in your life that's motivated by the wrong spirit, and man, they just start fussing and fighting with what God's trying to do in your life. This is a supernatural opening of our eyes to see what was actually going on there. When you go to new levels, new devils are revealed. I didn't say new. Some of you are like, that's fine with me. I ain't going behind that door. There's devils back there. That's the wrong message, okay? Because this is a spiritual world. The Bible tells us that we're wrestling against spiritual things, you know, not flesh and blood, but principalities and powers and wickedness in the heavenly. This is going on. What I'm telling you is when you go to a new level, God reveals to you what's happening in your life. God dispatches angels to fight for you. In other words, instead of just being, you know, do you ever notice that it seems like Christians are no different from non-Christians? Come on, can we say amen to that? Divorce rate is the same between Christians and non-Christians. The way people live their life is the same between Christians and non-Christians. You know, their ethics, when you ask people ethical questions, it's the same between Christians and non-Christians. And it'll make you believe that's the only fact the media will present about that. And those are facts, but those are based on surveys. You just ask people, what are you? And they tell you, I'm a Christian, I'm a non-Christian, I'm a Jew, I'm a whatever. And then when you ask them those other questions, they come up the same. But if you change that survey and you ask people, how often do you attend church? You find people who are truly committed to the local church. This is a fact. The divorce rate is half what it is among the rest of the community and the rest of Christians. The ethical standards are half. The wealth is twice as much. What you see, you begin to see the true benefit of being a follower of Jesus, the unity in your home, the blessing He pours out on your home. When you take your life to a new level, God releases supernatural blessing in your life, and you learn that the natural is never as important as the supernatural, and the physical is never as important as the spiritual. See, God is taking us to a new level. He's taking you. He wants you to go behind this door and go to a new level. And if and when you do, things are going to change. In fact, I can give you one warning. Like, you're going to make decisions that other people around you might not like. They might find you a little bit strange or odd. I remember myself going from a nominal, just kind of street-level Christian as a young man. And going to a new level. I was in college, graduated high school, went away to college. I had lots of scholarships, man. I just got super blessed. I wasn't the smartest kid in my school. It was just weird how it worked out. Just got lots of scholarships. Wasn't the most talented. I had so many scholarships. My food and my meals and my apartment was covered with scholarships. All my tuition was covered with. I paid my parking tickets with scholarship money. That happened. That's a fact. Just park wherever I wanted to and bring them a handful of tickets later on. Take it off my tab. I cashed one of them out. They gave me cash back. I painted my 66 Mustang midnight metallic blue. It was pretty awesome back in the days, I got to tell you. I sold one of my scholarships. True story. Put somebody else's name at the top of it. They put it in his name. He gave me cash. That's probably illegal, but pretty sure the statute of limitations is over. I can admit it right now. It was just rolling for me, man. I was like a professional college student. It was working out great. And then God spoke to me. I went to this little church. Went to this little church right off campus. I went to a new level. I was going to be an engineer on my own business. Went to a whole new level. God said, no, you're going to do something else. Some people thought that was pretty crazy. I gave that up. Went to Bible college instead. Left all that scholarship stuff. Went somewhere else. Had to pay to go to Bible college. Getting to go free over here to be an engineer, got to pay to go to Bible college. Looked weird. Why would you do those kind of things? God was taking me to a new place. Not long after that, I'm a youth pastor at a great, wonderful, big church in Mobile. And this little church in Dodge City, Alabama, this little opportunity comes up. Seems tiny. I now know it was a gigantic opportunity. Seemed tiny. And I said yes to that. Man, I took off and I moved to Dodge City, Alabama, because I'd been behind the door, y'all. I'd been in the upper room. God said something to me, and what everybody else was saying didn't seem like it mattered anymore. And I had lots of friends who were like, you're going where? There's a Dodge City, Alabama? That's where you're going? It didn't make any sense to them. But I had been to a place where God spoke to me. And what God has done in my life since then, blessing my family. It's not just church stuff, y'all. It's not just ministry stuff. When God blesses you, it's holistic. He touches your children, your wife, your family. Unity comes together. What God has done in my life when I went behind the door to the upper room has been amazing. And God wants to do more for me and more for you. There's another door for me. I'm not telling you I've been there, I live there, it's all perfect where I'm at, come be like me. No, there's another door for me. There's another level for me. There's a higher place for me, and there's more for you. Can somebody say amen? Amen. Something else God wants to do for you. There's a higher place for you. There's a great big opportunity that looks like a speck of dust right now. You just don't know it, but he's going to whisper, and he's going to say, go this way, and you're going to grab that speck of dust, and it's going to blow up in your life into joy and blessing and fulfillment and a calling and a life change. He has the same for you.